And so we are to see the broken Jesus in everyone, to love them, and to remember what St. Peter had to say to us, that we are to return a blessing for a curse, because there are people out there who will behave as our enemies, and yet we are to turn the other cheek, as Jesus said. We are to be Jesus to these people. That means to love them, and that means to return that blessing for a curse. Point to ponder is on the word love. Love, the master key. And if you have a pencil and paper ready, it would help you a lot to be able to remember just exactly what I'm talking about today. Everything in this world that is good, doesn't matter what it is, everything in this world that is good is summed up in one word, and that word is love. St. Paul tells us, if I speak with the tongues of angels and have not love, I am a clanging cymbal. In other words, I'm nothing. I'm nothing at all without love. I have to love. I have to love my God and love my neighbor and so on. Love my wife. And so this idea of love is the centerpiece of Christian life. It is agape love. That is to say, the love with which Christ loves us is the love with which I am to love others, my neighbor, my wife, and so on and so forth. And so I'm a clanging cymbal. It means that without love, St. Paul has made it very clear to us that we are, in fact, nothing at all. Now, there are six different categories of love, which you didn't know about, and I didn't know about anyway until recently, six different categories of love which are approved of by the Church. And it would be good if you could write these down for later reference. The first, and these are in descending order. First is love of God. Second, love between husband and wife. Third, love of parent for the child. Four, love of neighbor. Five, love for knowledge. Six, love of work. These are the six loves which should inform us about how we are to behave and what kind of Christian and Catholic we are to be in God's eyes. And so, love of God. We are to love God above all things, above all creatures, above everything created. And so it is very important for us to do this with the knowledge that I am to love God more than I love my wife. And my wife is to love God more than she loves me. And this is validated, as you know, by my body. My body, surprisingly enough, does not belong to me anymore. Once I entered into the marriage covenant, I offered my body to my wife. It belongs to her, and her body belongs to me. This doesn't mean that we can do whatever we like, and I will be talking about that in a later point to ponder. However, we are to love God above everything, and that is very, very important. And what we owe God in our love is a form of adoration, a form of praise, a form of thanksgiving, a form of worship, which we call latria. And that's L-A-T-R-I-A. It's a Latin word, and it is reserved exclusively for God and God alone. We can worship the Holy Spirit. We can worship Jesus. We can worship God the Father. But all three deserve this latria. We glorify the Mother Mary, of course, and we do that with joy and with the greatest of satisfactions and prayer. But we do not give her latria. That is reserved for God and God alone. Two, love of husband and wife. love of husband and wife is both spiritual and erotic. And do I love and obey my wife? That may surprise you. Obey my wife? Yes, we are to obey each other. She is to obey me, I am to obey her, in all things except sin. It's the mystery of Christ and his church. That mystery of what we call marriage is a sacrament, and in it, wives are requested to obey their husbands, and husbands are asked to mutually and likewise obey their wives. It's found in the letter to the Ephesians by St. Paul. And so there is a mutual obedience going on here, and it's a beautiful and wonderful thing. Three is love of parent for child. And this love is validated by the parents' love for each other. It's very important. If the parents love each other as they should, then they would both automatically love their child with a beautiful and undying love. A child is the principal fruit of that love. And it's a Trinitarian relationship, husband, wife, and child. The husband represents God the Father in the family, and he is the moral authority of the family. The wife is the one who is known by the husband, just as Jesus is known by the Father. And so the wife represents, in a sense, Jesus in the family, and she is the love authority of the family. The wife is to obey the husband in all moral things. The husband is to obey the wife in anything connected with love and loving and how to love more beautifully than ever before. The child is the fruit of the love of the father to the one who is known, the wife, and that fruit represents the Holy Spirit. And so you have that beautiful Trinitarian notion of Father, Son, Spirit, husband, wife, child. Fourthly, love of neighbor. That is to see Jesus in every single human being. Yes, even a street person, somebody who is an alcoholic, who is psychotic, who has schizophrenia, so an ordinary human being in the street that you meet every day. Someone who has violated you with anger, resentment, hurt, betrayal, stealing, whatever it may be. When you do that, you see them as Jesus. You can see the broken Jesus in them because nobody is perfect. You will see a Jesus who is broken, a Jesus who loves them, a Jesus who inhabits them. And so in seeing that, it becomes easy to recognize a brother and sister in every single human being, to accept their faults and to pray for them, and to pray especially for the evil ones, the ones who in this world have abandoned God, the ones who in this world have denied God. And so we are to see the broken Jesus in everyone, to love them, and to remember what St. Peter had to say to us, that we are to return a blessing for a curse, because there are people out there who will behave as our enemies, and yet we are to turn the other cheek, as Jesus said. We are to be Jesus to these people. That means to love them, and that means to return that blessing for a curse. The fifth love is knowledge. Now, this does not necessarily mean education, and higher education and getting to a university and getting several degrees from the universities. It doesn't mean that at all. It means knowledge of God, the science of God, to fall in love with God and to do what we can to learn more and more and more about God's mystery. It's a mystery that we cannot ever fathom. We'll spend eternity fathoming the mystery of God. And eternity is forever. Eternity is infinite, since God is infinite. But here on earth, we can improve our knowledge of God greatly by studying the scriptures, by listening to good homilies, by getting to Catholic conferences, and listening to accomplished speakers. There are all kinds of ways in which we can learn about who God is, what God is, what he is doing for us and what he has done for us, and what we are to be grateful for, leading us to count our blessings more and more and more each day, for they are infinite. Then finally, love of work. In the sense of work as an imitation of God's 6 days of creative work, so yes, we are to work 6 days a week in some useful way or another. And important thing here is, it doesn't just mean to work for 6 days of the week as God did. It means to imitate God and to rest on the Sabbath day. We are to keep the Sabbath day holy no matter what. That is so vital to understand. Yes, you may have to work on the Sabbath day, as I had to do as a doctor and as a fireman has to do and so on. All kinds of people have to do work on a Sunday. But the fact of the matter is, they can still make Sunday a holy day, and they must make Sunday a holy day by getting to Mass, by saying prayers, by saying the rosary, in whatever way you can see fit, but to give God some time of that day, instead of just making it a day of work, and for many people, unfortunately, a day of sports and pastimes where God is neglected. So, how do you stand up then? How do you stand up as a lover? There are six loves. Where do you stand with regard to those? Do you love work more than your wife? If you do, you're a workaholic. You're avoiding your wife, you're avoiding your children, you're avoiding your responsibilities in life, and justifying that by saying, I have to work. Is your wife more important to you than God? If she is, you've got it wrong. You've placed her ahead of the infinitely good God who created her and created you and gave you to each other to love and to love him. Do you detest a neighbor? So are you judging him or her? Are you angry with him? Are you refusing to turn the other cheek? Are you refusing to forgive? Do you value your education above holy knowledge? Do you think that it's more important for you to have a PhD from a prestigious university than it is to read the scriptures to learn the science of God? Many people do that, and they think that they're in love with holy knowledge, but they're not. They're in love with secular knowledge. And unfortunately, what does education do for many, many people, as I found out in my university days? Education stimulated pride in the person who had great book knowledge. Oh, they'd learned a great deal. They could quote this and quote that from this book and that book. And they were very erudite and convincing in their arguments. But they were exhibiting a kind of intellectual pride. Pride. So that there was very little humility in the way that they approached their clients and their fellow academics. And the result was one of refusal of humility, of being a man who knows exactly who he is and what he is in the face of the world and in the face of men. He is very little, very small, and very, very much loved by God and in need of that humility which we have mentioned. So may the God of peace make you perfect in holiness. May he preserve you whole and entire, spirit, soul, and body, irreproachable at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. And so may Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.